This series is a brief introduction to what little I know about logic. This is part 2. Watch the previous part if you didn't already. Now, so far, we have discussed only cases with at most two variables. In reality, logical expressions may have many inputs. Suppose that we have this 4-input truth table, where for every combination of inputs A, B, C, and D, we have figured out the intended outcome Q. Now the naive approach would be to go through every line that has true for the result and analyze what is the expression responsible for that true value. For example, this first true has 0 for A, 0 for B, 0 for C, and 1 for D. So we write a term that has ABC inverted and D verbatim. Repeating the process for every single line that has true for the result, we get this monstrous expression. A total of 10 different combinations that may produce true value. If we build a circuit from this formula, it would look something like this. Very wasteful. Can we do better though? We could notice some patterns in the truth table. For example, these two groups look identical. It looks here like the result is the value of D, and this is done when B is false. And these two groups look identical. It looks like their result is the disjunction between C and D, and this is done when B is true. Is this the optimal result? No, it's not. Let me introduce a concept called Karnaugh maps. In a Karnaugh map, we transfer the truth table from a one-dimensional list into a two-dimensional grid, where half of the inputs are placed on the vertical axis and the rest of the inputs are placed on the horizontal axis. Furthermore, instead of a binary-coded order, the input combinations are ordered by gray code, where only one of the variables changes between successive rows or columns. The values are filled in the respective slots, 16 slots just like before. Now we begin identifying where the ones lie in the map. We do that by marking them using rectangular markings, where both the width and the height are powers of 2. That is, 1 is fine, 2 is fine, 4 is fine, but 3 is not fine. The aim is to mark as big rectangles as you can, as long as there are no zeros under it. In this case, we can get a big 2x4 rectangle in the middle of the map. Then we can get another. This is fine, but we can actually do better. It does not matter if the markings overlap. Overlaps are absolutely fine. What you want is a minimal number of rectangles that encompasses all of the ones in the map, and have those rectangles as big as possible. In this case, we get 2 rectangles. Now the next step is to identify the expressions corresponding to each rectangle. This is done by identifying which variables are constant throughout the rectangle. For the big one, these variables are D and nothing else. D is the only constant throughout this rectangle, and it is always 1. For the square, those variables are B and C. And for that, we get a very nice and tidy optimal expression that is in the disjunctive normal form, which means it is a disjunctive expression built from conjunctions, and it fulfills the truth table. The Karnaugh map can also be built using zeros instead of ones. Here we can first identify a slender rectangle of zeros that corresponds to not C and not D. In the corners we have a 2x2 square of zeros that corresponds to not B and not D. This gets us a minimal expression that is built entirely using negatives. Notice that it is just a coincidence that in this case all the variables were 1 when we were collecting ones and 0 when we were collecting zeros. It isn't that way necessarily. If you find a constant 1, you mark the name of that input. If you find a constant 0, you mark the name of that input inverted. Join the variables with a conjunction when they were together within that rectangle and the different term groups with disjunctions. Finally, if you were collecting zeros, invert the entire expression. Now, if we apply De Morgan's laws on this expression, we get two useful outcomes. The first one is a form that is built entirely using NOR gates, if that's your thing. Just 3 NOR gates. It is very optimal. Applying De Morgan's laws again, we get the conjunctive normal form, where the phrase is a conjunctive expression of disjunctions. Now we have a total of 5 distinct logical expressions that all fulfill the same truth table. In other words, they are logically equivalent. I have also drawn a circuit diagram corresponding to each of these expressions. You can maybe now appreciate how digital engineering is as much an art as it is a science. Previously we explored 2 valid conclusions that we can make using the material implication. The modus ponens, which is that if A implies B and A is true, then B must be true. The modus tollens, which is that if A implies B, but B is false, then A must be false. However, if A implies B and B is true and you conclude that A must be true, then you are invoking the fallacy of the converse, better known as the fallacy of affirming the consequent. A implies B does not lead into the deduction that B implies A. Likewise, if A implies B and A is false and you conclude that B must be false, then you are invoking the fallacy of the inverse, also called denying the antecedent. A implies B does not lead into the deduction that not A implies not B. That would be equivalence. We previously discussed equivalence, but implication is not equivalence. Notice how I coloredly introduced the turnstile symbol. The turnstile symbol is just a short way of saying that from some premises we can make a conclusion. For example, the De Morgan's laws can be expressed using the turnstile. When not A or B, it is valid to conclude that not A and not B. When not A and B, it is valid to conclude that not A or not B. Likewise for the modus ponens and modus tollens. When A implies B and A is true, it is valid to conclude that B is true. When A implies B and B is false, it is valid to conclude that A is false. The inverse of the turnstile can also be used to express fallacies. When A implies B and A is false, it is invalid to conclude that B is false. When A implies B and B is true, it is invalid to conclude that A is true. Let's do a little field trip. What do logic gates actually look like? This is a random collection of little integrated circuits, mostly 74 series, that I unpacked from my personal collection that I have for no reason at all. There are some logic gates in here. For example, here we have a couple dozen quad 2 input NAND gates. Here is 20 something quad 2 input NOR gates. These are OR gates and these are AND gates. I spy even some XOR and XNOR gates. How do I know this? Because each of these chips has a number code on it, indicating what kind of chip it is. Actually, most chips have multiple codes on them. It sometimes takes some deciphering to figure out which one of them is the chip type. Other information commonly included on the chip include the manufacturer's logo, the manufacturing date, and the country of origin. If you plug this chip type, say DM74LS32N, into a web search, you will find its datasheet. More to the point, most of these are part of the well-known 7400 series of chips, which are well documented. You can find a comprehensive list of these on Wikipedia and on many other sites. However, in the devices that you can see and buy today, you are not likely to find these components because of increasing integration and other reasons, but if you look at other devices, such as the graphics cards that I showed in my video, you can find many of these chips there. If I superimpose the datasheet of one of these chips on top of the chip, you can see how it is constructed. First, in the opposite corners there are power pins, one for ground and one for plus 5 volts. The rest of the pins are gates. This chip contains 4 gates, and each gate has 2 pins for input and 1 pin for output. You have to feed power to it for it to work, and then all the gates will be operative. The outputs, when they indicate false, will produce close to 0 volts relative to the ground, and when true, close to 5 volts relative to the ground. Likewise, it interprets its inputs the same way. It is actually possible to construct an entire computer from nothing but NAND chips like this, and in fact someone has already done so as a hobby project. Check out Kevin Horton's NANDputer if you would like to learn more. In part 3, we will explore logic that cannot be addressed with truth tables. See you soon again, have a very nice day.